थैंक यू वेरी मच।
नमस्ते
हाँ नमस्ते नमस्ते। स्टार्ट करना चाहिए।
लेट्स स्टार्ट सर, वी इंडियंस विल हैव
टू लर्न
हाउ टू बी ऑन टाइम।
ओके इट्स ऑल राइट, ओके इट्स ऑल राइट। यू नो वो सुने हैं ना आप, जो कहावत है, जो क्या बोला जाता है, जो जागा सो पाया, क्या होता है, आई डोंट नो दैट। सो वी शुड स्टार्ट नाउ एंड हियर I am, you know, it is Dr. Birendra Gupta from Faculty of Law, Patna University, as you know very well. And I have engaged your some classes about professional ethics. And in those classes, I think I have made you learn about the basic of ethics. Because, as I have said in the earlier classes, and what I wanted to mean exactly, how we can learn about ethics, how we can frame an ethics or ethical statement. So that I have already said in the previous classes. In this concluding class, I also like to make a discussion from all of you. It is very, as I have said, in a very simple statement, professional ethics may be defined. It is nothing but it is personal and corporate standard of behavior expected from professionals. Very simple. Of course, we have to say here that those standard of behavior are translated into code. No doubt in it. We have Consumers Act. We have now Competition Act. But what in this class, particularly for this class, I like to draw your attention towards the development of society. And we have reached a point where we started thinking about natural law or what ought to be. Now see, I am giving some examples for that. In a study of law, we used to make a debate about the journey of law from positivism, that is written law, to inherent power of the constitution. Now see, this is happening in all over societies. And I like to quote here the very, very good example of John Marshall, who was Chief Justice of Federal Supreme Court of America. And in order to unite American states, now mind here, American states after getting independence from English rule, they were completely an autonomous states. But the requirement was at that time how to get united, how those states should be united in order to have a federalism or a union. And every state is having its own constitution. That famous judge of American Federal Supreme Court has innovated inherent power of American constitution. And on the basis of that inherent power of American constitution, center had become very strong, and today we have United States of America. Now see, this point I am highlighting here because at some point of time, we have to say that after this positivism or after this positive law, we have our senses, and those senses are called in language of constitution, inherent power of the constitution. This is also called constitutional transformationalism. And the meaning is very, very simple. How we can get the target? How can we get the society united? And this point also I like to highlight here in my case or in case of professional ethics. Yes, it is all right that those professional ethics are translated into code, like we have Council of India rules in our case, or you can say in case of doctors, this is Medical Council of India rules. Some oaths are there to be taken before starting the practice. But as society developed, we now started thinking about, is it possible to say, or is it possible to understand that what are written there are sufficient to regulate a society or sufficient to define professional ethics? Now we have reached that point. We have reached that point. Thank you very much. We have reached that point. And at that point, I like to highlight in this class, because I have already stated many things. I have said that. I have also stated that when we talk about professional ethics, it is professional ethics. It is professional approach towards the society. Professional approach towards, you can say, dealing with client or providing services, or professional ethics towards or in relation to the employees who are working in the institutions or the profession. And of course, as I have said, we have codes to regulate all those things. But here I will like to highlight those points where we have to think about what should be the requirement of all these points or all these environment. It is very rightly said in this context that unless we have the sense of responsibility, and I will give very, very good example in my support. Unless we have sense of responsibility, only a written constitution are not going to provide us what are needed by the society. We must have sense of responsibility. And you know, the very good example of that sense of responsibility, a successful family. If a family is said to be or known to be successful, there is no constitution there. But only thing which is found in that family or those families are the sense of responsibility found in each and every member.
Sir, is that the reason that USA is called Coming Together Federation?
Exactly. See, I'm very happy that you asked this question. That sense of responsibility must be in so. And that codification must be having some sanctions. That I am going to say. But the point is what? If that sense of responsibility is there, then you can have or you can be getting a successful family. There is no constitution for that family. See, the best example is our nature. Our nature has provided us what are required by us. Even ozone layer, it's a big surprise for us who has made that ozone layer. It is nature's thinking. And as I have discussed in earlier classes, this is active reasoning as said by Aristotle. So sense of responsibility, when nature is having sense of responsibility, why not we have? See, on the basis of these two examples, I am going to float or cite a very good example of sense of responsibility. And it will be open a debate for all of you. When we talk about our voting rights, certainly we can say that we Indian do not have our sense of responsibility in this regard. We may vote, we may not vote. Now see, if we find unrest in the society, maybe several problems there, but why not to say that this is also one of the most important problems, that we don't have our sense of responsibility and we do not vote. So, sense of responsibility, and you know, we have reached that time where this sense of responsibility has to be converted into some codes or some law, and we have to see how those laws are going to be implemented. Because now we have time has come where we have to think about how those sense of responsibility should be converted or is converted into code, and how those codes or those rules are going to be implemented for the benefits of the society.
Sir, you had given example of family, sir.
Yeah, exactly.
If you will see in USA, all the states have different constitutions, but yeah, they came together with a sense of responsibility for growth of one nation. In the same way, you will see in successful families, people will be of different mindsets,
very good.
Will come together for one common objective.
This is completely what Kant has said. I think you must be knowing all those things because you have come in debate earlier also. Man is the master of his own discretion. And what nature is having, the nature has transferred to a man. Now he is master of his own will. So why not to think as the nature is thinking?
Yes, sir.
But here I like to draw your attention towards what I was saying. Why not to first of all think about sense of responsibility, and secondly, why not to codify those sense of responsibility and mind my language in such a way that those sense of responsibility may be implemented in our society. Now see, I am given by Kelsen. You are not supposed to, or I am not saying that you have to remember all those things, but you just remember the name of Kelsen who has given the theory. The name of theory was condition and precedent theory. And it is very much seen here in the society. Today we can see that theory in the society. And we have to think about professional ethics in that form. And I will ask you at the last that is it possible to implement those sense of thinking or those sense of responsibility which are transferred into code or which are converted into code have any opportunity to be prevailed in the society? That I am going to ask at last. But let me first finish my theory, which says condition and precedent theory. It says that suppose you have not taken the vaccination of COVID, you will be not getting some benefits from the society or from the government. Now see, it was your duty. It is your duty to take vaccination or this COVID vaccination. But yes, it is your discretion. And if you apply your discretion, it is also very much true in case of when you exercise your voting rights. These all things are coming under sense of responsibility, and the system is think responsibility may be converted into a code, into a binding code. But fear should not be there. This you have to take a very important point of mine. The code should be there, and that code should be a binding code, but there is no scope of fear. How is it possible? It is possible only on the basis of this theory that I am saying, condition and precedent. If you don't follow the law, or if you follow the law, some rewards are there. If you don't follow the law, yes, okay, it's all right. You are not, it is your discretion. You may not follow the law, but some benefit you have to lose some benefits which are there on the side of government. So once you understand professional ethics, whether it is towards the society, whether it is towards providing services, or towards the employees who are working in an institution in this way. So I was talking about, or I like to draw your attention towards this type of mechanism or this type of samikaran, you can say, on the basis of which professional ethics code can be implemented, or they are implementing it. It is not a new thing for me or for us. These things are implemented in a professional institutions where you are getting reward for your good work, and also losing benefits when you forget all this sense of responsibility. So in the first point that I like to make very clear in front of all of you, that unless we have got this sense of responsibility, no idea of professional ethics can be implemented in any professional institutions. And second point that I have highlighted, that this sense of responsibility should be there in form of a code, and that code must not be having sense of fear or element of fear. So now society, you know, even Supreme Court of India has said about constitutional transformationalism, an inherent power of the Constitution. So this inherent power of the Constitution is what? Now society has developed. We have to think in such a way that we must feel the human values. And referring here theory of Aristotle, we can think about human values. If any person denies, he may be some exceptions of all these things. But what insight we have got from the nature, we can think over it. So now time has come where we have to think about or think above the code, above the rules, as Constitution of India was thought in form of inherent power of the Constitution. So we have got some acts like Women Harassment Act, or you know, you can say Consumers Act, or here I am going to cite one more example, a very good example of Competition Act of 2002. Competition Act of 2002. Now see, the words I am using or which are used in this act are very interesting to know. And I think so far I have made an interaction with all of you. You will be also thinking about, or thinking in a way that I am thinking, is it right to say, or is it proper to have such type of laws? Because these episodes or these events are in everyone's eyes clearly against human values. But okay, we have got this act. The words which are used in this act of 2002, Competition Act of 2002, anti-competitive agreements. Now see, very interesting to know, anti-competitive agreements. Suppose two businessmen come together and make such an equation which are not in favor of a general public. You can say very good example is hoarding or raising of price. Who will say that these things are very good? But we have got such, so we have the system is pressurized to bring that law in the society? Is it not against the insight that I have explained earlier?
Actually, sir, it is very sad that the court and law has to teach us. We are born as humans and they have to teach us how to be
very
humane
good.
And how have to have
very
humanistic
good, very
values.
Good. Very good. And the second point I like, second word I like to say here. See, it is also very surprising. Abuse of dominant position. Now, these things are there in the section. And as I said, Section 3 of Competition Act 2002. Abuse of dominant position. Very surprising. Abuse of, if you are in a dominant position in a profession, is it right to say that you have to abuse your dominance? No, it is not like that. But you know, what is the importance of these codes? I like to highlight here that in which conditions, and that is why this is importance of this code is here, or this code is there, this code is there, or the system has been pressurized to draw this code or enact this code. In which position, in which circumstances for the court's review, or for the purpose of review, it is said to be that the businessman has misused his dominance position. Those positions should be declared. For the one fails to observe his duty. So unless we forget our duties, no question of right is there on the other side. So duty alives rights, I wanted to say.
Yes.
Why not to? Why not to? Yes.
Able to fulfill his duty, then only he can claim his right.
No question of rights and exercise of rights. Suppose
yes,
I am
sir.
Dutiful, I am dutiful, you are dutiful, and that is why I am talking about sense of responsibility. So now society has come, and I like to, from your statement, I have remembered one very important point, that in a study of law, as I was saying, in a study of law, we have got a journey from positive law to natural justice or to natural law, which is called,
yes, sir,
in field of law, that we have emphasized the positive law, that is written law. But written law, as Supreme Court has said, it is in form of codification. It is in codified language, and we have to interpret that codified language. And also said that words cannot be every time a good medium of communication. So every time, very very sensitive and very careful interpretation is needed in our lives also. So why not all those things we like to use in case of professional ethics? Because it is now the demand of the society. So just keep your thinking above codifications or code. And what I was saying, that there was a time when one author has says, his name was Austin, that law is what? It is the command of the sovereign. Or it is what is law? It is made by the legislature. What legislature has not made, it is not a law. Now we have come to a point, now come to a stage, and you know, I'm passing very important statement. Now we in 21st century, or you can say 20th century also, we have come to the point from what I am saying, from the journey had started from where there is law, there is remedy. And we have reached in 21st century or 20th century, what is legitimately expected from me, I have to do. That is, from the stage where there is law, there is remedy, to a stage where legitimate expectation is also coming under law, under review, you can say. So we are living in an era where if law is not there, legitimate expectations is there, or legitimate expectations are there. And if those legitimate expectations are not fulfilled, it is a matter of review. And there are remedies about that, or upon that. These all mechanism, or these all words, are coming under dignified life, what is given or mentioned in Article 21 of Indian Constitution. So why not to think about professional ethics in such a way that it is related to dignified life of everyone, and everyone is having its legitimate expectation. Is it necessary to see all those legitimate expectation in form of code? No. It is not like that. It should not be like that. We have to see, or we have to feel, the human values. And those human values, I like to also mention here a very famous quote, that what it is common conviction of what is right. But those common convictions, as I have said in the earlier classes also, must be suiting the infrastructure of the society. And all interest cannot be a right. Only those interests are right which are enforceable in the court of law, which are related to society, or which are related to...
We discussed this, sir, in our first class, that all natural laws are not human
exactly.
laws.
Exactly. That is you know, the second statement that I am saying, I had said. The second statement, the technical statement I am saying, that all interest cannot be a right. And all interest, I have some ill interest also. Those interests should not be in form of right. So only those interests are right which are useful for the society, for the benefits of the society, for the benefits of the individuals. So these all things are, or these all equations are, making a clear indication that now we have reached a stage where we have to think about our sense of responsibilities. And as I have said, how to transform those sense of responsibility into a code without no thinking, or you can say we have to eliminate or to keep the fear element far, far distant from that equation or that code. And I have said examples of it is, as I have said, the example of right to vote. So if it is duty to vote, and I'm asking this first time this question to all of you, suppose we have made provisions in which we have got duty to vote, and if you don't observe your duty, you will be losing so many benefits from the side of government. Now, according to you, what is the probability of observing this duty to vote?
Yes, sir, please repeat the question. What is?
What is the probability, or what is the chances, that a person will go and cast their vote if that is duty to vote?
The probability will be very, very high, sir.
Very high.
Sir, because the psyche of a person works, most of the people, their psyche works
exactly
on the base of either greed or fear.
So exactly.
If they lose something, they will go to vote. If you make them afraid that I will kill you, if you will not vote, you will be arrested, they will go to vote.
So,
that is
so,
the
same. So happy I am. I'm so happy because I have communicated my theme or what should be the meaning of professional ethics. Now, you all were knowing, or you all are knowing about the spirit of this professional ethics. So, now I like to make a discussion about, you know, what, why I'm smiling, because once I have said all those things, there is no scope of anything for my interaction, because the basis is what? It is sense of responsibility, and you have got my point. Now see, one thing, for the sake of understanding, or for the sake of writing, or for the sake of examination, you may say, I like to highlight here, in case of professional ethics also, although this statement what I am going through is a statement of a very famous judge, and his name was Krishna Iyer, V.R. Krishna Iyer. And on the basis of his statement, I like to highlight. Hello?
Yes, sir. Your voice had dipped after you were saying Krishna Iyer.
Ha 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 ha. Ha, le rahe hain. Ha, class le rahe hain.
Yes, sir.
Hi, ba.
Voice is reduced to a bit.
Okay. Hello. Hello.
Yes sir, now you are audible.
अरे आवाज, okay. बिजली चली गई।
कृष्णा अय्यर के बारे में बता रहे थे।
हाँ, yes. और ये, this would be the concluding part of my lecture, and you have got so many things as I came to know from your interaction. So, what is very relevant in case of India, and taking into consideration that we have got independence in 1947, and before that we were not in a position to think all those things that I have stated here. All these things must be considered before going we are Krishna Iyer statements, and it is very important here in case of professional ethics. Justice V.R. Krishna Iyer has said that India, with all its thousand of years of culture, again I am repeating one statement, every words are very important. India, with all its thousands of years of culture, heritage, and Vedic vintage, has not been able to assure to its people even a pretense of the preamble's grand understanding of justice, equality, and fraternity to every citizen. In that shell, we can say, he was saying, that we have got preamble of the constitution where socialism, brotherhood, equality, fraternity, all those things were there or are there. And even after such a long period of independence, we are not getting the benefits of all those words or all those concepts which are mentioned in the preamble of the constitution.
Sir, please make us write that statement, India with all
okay,
its thousands.
Right. Okay, it's all right. India with all its thousands of years of culture, heritage, and Vedic vintage, V-I-N-T-A-G-E, Vedic vintage, has not been able to assure to its people even a pretense, P-R-E-T-E-N-C-E, even a pretense of the preambles, apostrophe hai, pretense of the preamble's grand understanding of justice, equality, fraternity to every citizen.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. So this statement or this sentimental statement of Justice V.R. Krishna here is very important to discuss here in our context, because Indian context is not a context like we can give example of America or American states. Although we have to say that American states are also under the rule of English people, but their status was different. We have been exploited during English rule, and when we got independence, social development, industrial development were the prime requirement. And at that stage, we were not in a position to think about human values. Okay, all right. At that stage, has gone. But what we carried forward from all those experiences, that is the English rule as well as the developing status or developing stages, we were not in a position to frame such policies which were said to be based upon Indian culture and Indian heritage. And take very positively this statement. We were not in a position. And that is why we have got, in case of education, for example, Lord Macaulay's policy. That policy might be very suitable to their country or his country, but here for us, the facts were there that policy was not suitable to our society. And so far those industrializations were concerned, we have got human resource department, HRD, human resource development department. Human as a resource, not as a human being, but human as a resource. Such type of things were there that we have carried forward. But we had to think about, or we had been thinking from a very, very long time, that one day, if we find ourselves in a position to change all those things, we should change all those things. And the National Education Policy 2020 is coming now, where we find a student as a human being. And what are the requirements of human being or a students, whether it is a matter of English language or mother tongue? Everything, after some days, you will be finding out in this National Education Policy. And then we can say, or we can imagine about education, or you can say equality in education. Equality, the concept of equality says, like should be treated alike. This is the requirement of Article 14 of Indian Constitution. So now we are coming to a phase is coming where we can talk about all those things. And so far, suppose I say one title, that professional ethics in professional, higher professional education. Higher professional education is growing day by day. And what should be the status of a student? What should be the status of a teacher? What should be the pattern of study? These all things are there or should be covered under this professional ethics. What should be the code for a student in this professional institutions? What should be the code for a teacher? And when we talk about teacher, we have to think about one very, very important thing, that in order to have effective management or effective educational environment in such higher institution of higher education, why not to think about our culture where teachers are in form of a saint, a technologist were in form of a saint, and those saint were teaching technology with sanskar. Why not those courses, those syllabus with technology having some elements of Bharat Bodh? So when we talk about professional ethics in these professional institutions, and the objective is what we have to get a good academic environment. And when I say good academic environment, it means that it should be students oriented, it should be teachers oriented. All these two parties must be satisfied with environment, and only that we may be successful in getting education, and so far teachers are concerned in providing education. So in this context, what this National Education Policy says, the syllabus must be based upon utilitarian approach. What we are getting from our teachers must be having some professional objective. And if once we get such type of things, now time has gone when we have to understand the way that it is a law because it is passed by the legislature. No, that law must be having some utilitarian approach. That law must be effective in the society, for the students, for the teachers, for the society itself, for the organization itself. And if that code or if that rules or law, you can say, are made in such a way or seen in such a way, we have got as a result every institutions of the society would be functioning at his best. Every institution, when I say society, can be defined on the basis of institutions. Like commerce is a societal institution, education is another societal institution, family is a societal institution, and in every societal institutions we have got some rules, and that rules must be in accordance with the requirement of that societal institution and must be based upon values, and those values must be Indian. This is very important. Those values must be Indian. If those Indian values are there, it is not very surprising that the government has to apply some sanction to enforce those values or those rules which are based upon values. But those rules are found to be automatically accepted by the members of that institution. So here I am talking about the basic of this professional ethics, which are dependent upon so many points. And you can say, if we go through all those points and do not forget that one societal institution is related to another societal institution, and if unrest is found in one societal institution, another societal institutions or other societal institution cannot be at rest. So I think, in order to conclude my brief or my submission at last, I like to cite here the contribution from the side of government. The contribution from the side of government should be what? To protect those policies or to make such policies which are suitable to every societal institution. And when it is suitable to every societal institution, it should be based upon the values of Indian citizens. From the side of teachers, we should not forget that, as you know, in Hindi it is very effective to say that Chanakya ne kaha ki vikas aur vinash dono shikshakon ke saath rehte hain ya shikshakon ke god mein palte hain. Very rightly he has said. From the side of teachers, the education of technology, you can become an expert in technology, whether it is medical profession, whether it is engineering, whether it is law, whether it is any branch of study, you can become expert of that. But you should not forget that our teachers, our primitive teachers, were saint, and they simultaneously transfers technology with sanskar, as I have said. So,
sir, an educated man without ethics is much more dangerous than an uneducated man.
very good.
Because see, if there, if someone is uneducated, he will fight with lathi. If someone is exactly. educated and he is not having ethics, he will make nuclear bombs. He will kill whole world.
Very good. Very good. Very good. So, from the side of government, we need this to support such type of policy, to make such type of policy, not to make a policy which are. So at that time it was requirement. It might be a requirement at the time of independence, but now we have reached such a position where we have to think about all those things. So from the side of government, and government has thought very well thought, and we have got now national education policy. From the side of teacher, as I have said, teacher in Indian context, now I can say I have learned you well versed in this philosophy. So I can cite here. Teacher, from the eye of the student, you can see, and it is always seen in Indian context. Guru hamesha se ek ideal Bharatiya parampara mein raha hai. So, you know, it's a very, very important thing I like to also highlight here. One theory which is called Volkjis theory. Volkjis means what? It is Atma. And when we say that we are Indian, the Indian Atma is there inside my body. And that Atma cannot die. Even from primitive stage to the current stage or through the contemporary society, we see that those Indianity has traveled a lot. And today also we are called an Indian citizen or Indian. Even we go to England, people say that he is an Indian. So that having a big meaning. So in Indian context, we cannot forget that teachers are always ideal for a student. Whether you are studying in a technological institution or higher institutions, but you see your teacher as an ideal. Teacher has to understand all these things, and he has to make his personality an ideal personality, and to convey or to educate their students technology, as I said, technology as well as sanskar also. From the side of the student, and it is found very much enough in Indian society. It is sufficiently present in Indian society, because I also, as a student, take all my teachers not as a teacher but as a guru. And I find also in the society, whether it is Bihar or whether it is any state, most of the people or most of the citizen of the country take their teachers as a guru. And what parampara we are maintaining, it is very difficult to see Eastern world. So such type of things, I think, not only it is already present. The only thing from the side of society or from the side of government, we have to support all those things. And if we support all those things by making such a policy, not to make such policy which are not suitable in the society, and the teacher who is drawn up in Western type of policy and teaching Indian students, he will be finding a big confusion while performing his teaching duty. So at last, I like to sum up all those things by saying that professional ethics having so many dimensions. Dimensions from the point of view of professional institutions. And inside professional institutions, the professionals working inside the professional institutions. And also I highlighted here the example of educational institution, where we must have a code on the basis of the requirement of that professional institutions, and of course not ignoring Indian values. And then you will be finding out that those codes are automatically, as I have said, accepted in the society. There is no question of sanction or fear to be applied for the enforcement of those codes. Like a very big issue here, at last, in the last, I like to say, a very big issue about the status of a girl student or a woman in a professional institutions. Now we find that because of, as I have said, because of severe industrialization that was needed by India, we have got, or we were raised in a position where we had to interact with the machines. It is well said that what the thing to which you are making an interaction, there is exchange of quality or exchange of nature between the two parties of the interaction. When we are interacting with machine, the valueless, or you can say value absent quality, had been transferred from the machine to the human being. And it is well said, it was well confirmed in the 19th century when one jurist in England has said that minimal requirement of natural law or natural rights should be there in making of laws. He has very rightly said, because we have lost our human values at that time. And also, as I have said, it was the requirement, but now we have got, or we have reached such a stage where we have to forget all those things, and we have to. And in the last, I like to quote here a very famous statement, or very good statement of very famous or very popular judge of Patna High Court, that is Justice S.N. Jha, who has said, when I was doing a refresher course in Patna University, he has come at the end, and you know, after getting so much knowledge about human rights, one statement that he has said, I thought that this statement is enough. He has said that if you have feeling about human beings, you are expert in human rights. So at last, or in the end, also it comes sense of responsibility. And I like to finally sum up that sense of responsibility should be there with a thinking how that sense of responsibility should be codified in such a way that people, while following those codes, should not have any fear to follow those codes. So with that, thank you very much. You have heard me. You have given me such a time. Thank you very much.
I have this feeling, sir, for human beings.
Sir, right. I have a query, sir.
Thank you very much. Haan, boliye.
Hello, boliye.
Sir. Haan, boliye. Sun rahe hain.
Sir, we have talked of ethics, samskara and value, but sir, the psyche of the to remain slave of the British, sir, doesn't allow us to think beyond the Western values. And sir, we often see that the people faced harassment in the institutions like school and colleges when they privilege or give more preference to the Indian values. So do you think, sir, we need to some kind of reformation in the at the primary level, especially in NCERT texts, sir?
You said one question, and you have answered that question. Why not? It is all about that. I that is why I have said about this national education policy, where you have got, you will be getting so much transformation about all those atrocities or all those inequalities. Okay, it's all right. Next question. Okay,
thank you, sir.
Next question.
There is no question, sir, but I have understood something.
Okay.
I will tell you that what I have understood.
Okay, okay.
This is me, sir, Paramveer from Department of English.
Okay, okay, it's all right.
There are some people who think that I am from psychology department because you talk of psychology so much.
Actually, so, you know, English and psychology, both are, and both are, you know, parts of, you can say, a good understanding.
Yeah,
isn't it?
That's very right statement.
Okay, sir. Bully. No, careful.
That you said about that that French statement that love is a good sport, but a bad play. You will see that, sir, where in the society where you will see that love is always imposed, you will see that those people, they have lack of this responsibility because they only break the law and then law has to be imposed on them. If law is...
Yes, yes, you are right, very much right. Eventually, time is coming where we will be getting all those things. Now, you have to make a prachar prasara of all these things. You just go and interaction with your colleagues, with your students, in your families about this sense of responsibility. And with that sense of responsibility, such type of equation where those sense of responsibility may be codified in such a way, you have got this point or not?
Yes, sir. I've got this point very well. Very, that's why. Very, what I understood, I was explaining.
Yes, sir. Okay, okay. Now, please.
Thank you, sir. I've explained it, sir.
Okay,
that,
okay.
If you see
anyone,
that...
Anymore? Okay, okay. It's all right. Paramveer, okay. It's all right. I think I am 100% confident that you have understood my point. Any more?
Will you engage your class tomorrow?
I think I have to talk to my head of the department. Then I will say. Okay, it's all right. Thank you very much.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Thank you. It
was very good experience with you.
सबको बहुत अच्छा लगा, सबसे बात करके प्रणाम, बहुत अच्छा लगा. और प्रश्न पूछना चाहिए, प्रश्न नहीं पूछिएगा तो समझ में टीचर को नहीं आता है, लेकिन सबको प्रश्न पूछना चाहिए इफ यू हैव गॉट एनी क्वेश्चन. ओके देन, ऑल राइट, थैंक यू वेरी मच.
थैंक यू.